Hello, everybody. Welcome back to the session of Statistics and Data Analysis. It's my pleasure to introduce our next speaker, Oleg Lepsky. Oleg is at the Institut de Mathématique de Marseille, and he will talk us on theory of adaptive estimation. The floor is yours, Oleg.
Thank you, Nancy, for this introduction. So today, my talk is devoted to the theory of adaptive estimation, and it consists of two parts. The first part is a short introduction to the theory of adaptive estimation. And in this part, I present you the basic notion of this theory, like the notion of optimally adaptive estimator, adaptive rate of convergence, and some others. Also, we will discuss the fundamental problem of this theory related to the existence of optimally adaptive estimators. And in the end of this part, I present you some particular results. In the second part of my talk, I present you a very general estimation method, which is based on some random selection from given family of estimators. And here my goals are to present this selection rule. We will see that it possesses very simple explicit description, and to prove for selected estimator to find for the selected estimator the upper bound for its risk. And at last, we will discuss how to use this oracle type inequality in order to prove the adaptive property of the selected estimator. So let us start with first part. So this is the introduction to the minimax adaptive estimation. And first of all, I should recall you some notions of the modern statistical theory. So first, this is a notion of statistical experiments, experiment that is a measurable space and the family of probability measures on its sigma algebra. The word generated by observation simply means that the law of observation, so the observation is a random variable, belongs to this collection of probability measure. This collection of probability measure is parameterized by some set Gotic F, which is called parameter space. And for this talk, the parameter set is the set of measurable real function defined on some measurable space. We will keep in mind that Gotic F, this parameter space, is typically very, very, very big. And in fact, this is the largest set on which the statistical model can be perfectly defined. On define some mapping G on the parameter space, which act in some metric space denoted by Gotic S, and its metric L in the future will be considered as a loss functional. And our goal is to estimate this mapping from observation. What does it mean to estimate? By its definition, an estimator is a measurable function of observation, taking value in the same set that the estimated object. So in our case, the estimator takes its value in this metric space. The next important notion of statistical theory is the notion of the risk, which is given by this formula, which is defined for any estimator. What is it? We measure the distance between estimator and parameter to be estimated. This is a positive random. This is a positive random variable, and we consider its moment of order q. Now I present you two examples of statistical models, which I will use in the sequel. So the first very popular model is the density model on RD. In this model, we observe ID d-dimensional random vector distributed in accordance to unknown distribution P. And this distribution has a density with respect to Lebesgue measure. And this density is exactly the parameter describing this model. This observation generate this statistical model. Here, Gothic B denotes the Borellian sigma algebra. And you see that the family of probability measure has an explicit description. And you see that our parameter is the density, so our set of parameter is the set of all probability density on RD. In other words, the set of all positive measurable functions with integral equal to one. The second model, so-called white Gaussian noise model, this model is what the observation here is a collection of Gaussian random variables. And this collection is parametrized by L2 space. In fact, for given square integrable function G, we observe Gaussian random variables with mean, which is inner product of the function G and unknown function F, and the variance, which is squared L2 norm of the function J divided by N. This is a quite abstract description. In particular case, this model can be described more explicitly, so equivalent description. For example, if D is, say, interval 0, 1, if mu is a Lebesgue measure, then this model can be rewritten as follows. We observe a trajectory of stochastic process, which is simply integral of the unknown function f plus Brownian motion multiplied by some small constant. This observation generates the following statistical experiments, and in particular, the family of probability measures has explicit expression via Gersanov formula, and this probability is defined for any square integral function f. So the set of the parameter set for this model is L2 space. Now let us briefly discuss what kind of estimation problem is of our interest. The first one, and maybe the most important, is the estimation of parameter of the unknown parameter itself. I remind you that f is a real-valued function, and the typical distance between function are the LP norm or n supremum norm, and just this loss function will be used in the description of the risk. Another source of estimation problem is the estimation of functionals, and the typical examples are the estimation of the function or its derivative at a given point, the estimation of norm of this function, the point, the estimation of the point where the function take its maximum, the estimation of smooth functionals, and many, many others. Now let us briefly discuss the approach which is called Minimax one. In Minimax approach, what we do, we fix some subset of parameters, and associate to this set what is called maximality, so the supremum of the risk for given function for given function f. And after that, we minimize, we seek for the estimator which has a minimal maximal risk. So here infimum is taken over all possible estimator, in other words, over all measurable function of observation. I should say that the exact value of minimax risk, or even exact asymptotic of minimax risk, then n tends to zero, is known for very, very few problems. And typically we seek for the estimator whose maximal risk is proportional to minimax risk. And such estimator is called asymptotically minimax on this given set. Once again, the minimax approach is a criterion of optimality. So the estimator whose maximal risk is proportional to the minimax risk is of course optimal in the sense that it can be the accuracy given by this estimator cannot be improved. This is an advantage of minimax approach because really there is no any restriction imposed on the class of possible estimator. We consider all estimation methods, but the main disadvantage of this approach is that the construction of minimax estimator is heavily based on the choice of F. Maybe the first question which appears in minimax approach, why we consider some subset instead of the set of all the parameter space Gotic F. But I remind you that this set of parameters is typically very big, the quite typical situation is that the maximal risk on Gotic F is equal to plus infinity. We are interested in the estimation procedure. Minimax risk is equal to plus infinity or bound, in any case, doesn't tend to zero. The hypothesis that F belongs to some subset of parameter, some subset of parameters is some restriction imposed on the statistical model. The construction of our estimator depends on this knowledge, to construct the minimax estimator, we have to be sure that the function to be estimated, unknown value of parameter F, belongs to this set. There are at least two problems. If we choose this set is sufficiently small, in this case, typically we can guarantee that the minimax risk tends to zero rather rapidly. This is a good news, but it may happen that the underlying function does not belong to this set. And in this case, the risk of our optimal on this set estimator, so the risk of the minimax estimator is no more proportional of the minimax risk. And it's quite possible that even this risk does not tend to zero. Another problem arises if we choose this set too large. Of course, if it's very, very large, we already discussed it. In this case, the risk of the minimax risk does not tend to zero. Okay. Say that it's too large, but not really too. So in this case, then we have the minimax risk, which tends to zero. But it may happen that the underlying function belongs to the smaller set, where more accurate estimation procedure available. It's quite typical for many statistical methods that minimax estimator for this very favorable situation, nevertheless, has a risk proportional to minimax one on the set, on this big set F. And to overcome these two disadvantages, the minimax adaptive approach was proposed. Here we suppose that we are given by the collection of parameter sets F theta, and we will assume that the minimax problem is already solved on each set from this collection, so we know the corresponding to each set minimax estimator, and we know the value of minimax risk. The problem of adaptive estimation can be formulated as follows. We would like to find an estimator, say Gn star, which would be simultaneously minimax on each set from this collection. So the unique estimator, single estimator, whose maximal risk is proportional to minimax one on each set from this collection. If exists, such estimator is called optimally adaptive. The idea behind of the minimax adaptive approach is the following. We assume that the unknown parameter belongs to the union of this set, and this union is really very, 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 very big. Often the minimax risk, even the minimax risk on this set doesn't tend to zero. But in this collection, there are some sets on which the minimax risk tends to zero quite rapidly. But the problem, we don't know whether the underlying function belongs to such set or not. And therefore the estimator, optimally adaptive estimator, in some sense should adapt to this unknown information. It's more or less explain the word adaptive. The problem here that the optimally adaptive estimator do not always exist. For some statistical problem, for some scale of functional classes, for some estimation problem, one can prove the following result, that the minimax risk as a family, as a normalization is not achievable even for any two, for any couple of sets from our collection. I remind you that for if theta is fixed by the definition of rate of convergence, this normalization is achieved by minimax estimator. But for given value, it's possible. For even for two values, it's not possible. And but the question: suppose we now can prove this this result, and but the question how to construct the single estimator remain open, because even proving this, we don't know to which set from our collection the underlying function belongs. And the idea is very simple, that we say, okay, the family of normalization, which are minimax risk, is not achievable, but maybe another sequence is achievable. And we come to the definition of the adaptive rate given sets. So first, this family of normalization should be achievable by a single estimator. So it's the same requirement as previously. We only replace the minimax risk, which is not achievable, into by some other normalization. And the first line means that this family of normalization cannot be improved, at least for any couple of sets from our collection. So this is a criterion of optimality, and in this set, the estimator which satisfies this inequality is called psi-adaptive, in other words, optimal in a considered situation. And this ratio show how far the adaptive rate is from the family of optimal normalization, the family of minimax risk, and it's called the price to pay for adaptation. We can remark that in fact the optimally adaptive estimator is a particular case of psi-adaptive estimator. It just corresponds the collection of psi, which is which is a family of minimax risks. The fundamental problem of the adaptive theory consists in finding necessary and sufficient condition of existence of optimally adaptive estimators. In other words, we would like to understand how the existence or non-existence of optimally adaptive estimator depends on our statistical model, depends on what we would like to estimate, depends on the description of the risk, and of course, on the collection of considered classes. And in order to understand why this problem is extremely complicated and remain open more than 30 years, I would like to present you the example where we have one the same model, we have the same collection of functional classes, we have the same description of the risk, but just what is different, this is the estimation problem, but they have, say, similar nature. So we consider the white Gaussian noise model. We are interesting, we will be interested in the estimation of some functionals. So the risk of any estimator is given by this. I remind you that the minimax risk is defined as follows. And we consider the following collection of functional classes, which is simply the balls of radius one in Hölder space. This collection is parameterized by the number theta, which varies, which belongs to the interval 0, 1. So this is a subset of continuous bounded function. We will consider two estimation problem, estimation of L2 norm and the estimation of the supremum norm of the function. And it turned out that we can construct the optimally adaptive estimation of the supremum norm. But the optimally adaptive estimator for L2 norm doesn't exist. So we see that we have the same statistical models, the white Gaussian noise model. We have the same collection of functional classes. We have the same description of the risk. So our loss functional here is just absolute value. But we would like to estimate the norm. But the question are different. The answer are different. If we speak about the estimation of supremum norm, the problem is solved. We know how to construct the optimally adaptive estimator. But what can be done for the L2, for the estimation of L2 norm? So first, I should say that the asymptotic of minimax risk for this problem is known. It's given by this particular sequence. But in view of the proposition one, this family of normalization is not achievable. And it's turned out, we can prove it, that the achievable sequence is given by that. So this is the explicit formula for the adaptive rate of convergence. And I remind you that the definition of the adaptive rate of convergence implies in particular the existence of psi adaptive estimator for this norm. So we can construct an estimator whose maximal risk is proportional to this guy for any values of theta. There are price to pay for adaptation, easily to compute it. So we have to pay, but we see we have to pay not so much, because the price to pay for adaptation increase with n, but logarithmically. So now let us proceed to the second part of my talk. Here I will speak about the quite general estimation construction, which based on the selection from a given family of estimators. So what is our problem? So we have an observation X, which generates this abstract statistical experiments. And also we are given by the family of estimator for some mapping J, taking value in some metric space. This family is parameterized by the set Hn, And I will assume for this talk that HN is finite set in order to discuss the measurability issues. So in this approach, we have a family of estimators instead of family of sets as in adaptive approach. What is our goal? Our goal is to construct measurable function of observation, taking value in this finite set, and after that to study the selected estimator. That means that our estimator is the estimator from this collection with index h hat n. More precisely, we would like to bound from above the risk of this estimator, but now we would like to do it for any function from the parameter space. In other words, for some value of f, it may be very big. For some, it may be very small. But we would like to have some uniform bound for the risk. To do that, we will need to construct several auxiliary objects. So first of all, we need to construct the family of auxiliary estimators, which parameterized by the couple of parameters. I call it auxiliary because this estimator are not used for estimation purposes. It will be used just for selection from our given family of estimator. And this family should satisfy this commutativity assumption. We should satisfy this commutativity assumption for any couple of parameters. Next object, which is not really related to the selection rule, it's related to the upper bound for the risk of the selected estimator. So in fact, to both this family, to both this family, we associate some collection of mappings, which are not random. Typically for the problem, for many problems where this technique has been already applied, this just the expected value of estimator from the given collection. The last object to construct is the collection of measurable function of our observation, which are positive. So measurable with respect to observation, positive functions. We will need once more assumption, and let us briefly discuss this assumption. So let us just discuss the first line of this. So we have an estimator, and suppose that this is just the expected value of this estimator. So we consider the distance between the particular estimator and its mathematical expectation, which is typically called stochastic error related to the estimator G hat. The problem here that the expected value typically depends on the underlying function F. So we cannot compute this distance. And after that, we seek for some random variable, because it's measurable with respect to observation. In other words, we can compute it. which is larger in this sense than this distance. So this is the upper bound in this particular sense. This is the upper bound for this unknown for us quantity. And in some statistical model, typically statistical model with additive noise, this distance does not depend on function f. In this case, omega n no more random, and in probability theory, it's called the upper function of order epsilon n for this collection of positive random variables. So here we just generalize the notion of upper function, allowing to it to be random variable. So now our selection proof is very simple, just two short lines. So first we consider this distance in some sense compensated by this omega n, and after that we minimize this particular sum. Once again, our selection rule is explicit, short, and used in fact three elements: the original family, the family of auxiliary estimators, and the collection of these positive random variables. What can be proved for that? The following result. So this is the risk of the selected estimator is smaller for this guy. The important here that it's proved for any value of parameter, and this is not asymptotic. It's proved for any value for any n. Once again, this is a so-called oracle type inequality, and first of all, it's completely explicit and even rather short, and its description is very short. Also, if we already discussed for some times the omega n is not random, then it's just we can replace small omega n by capital omega n in this case. You see that this is all constant are explicit and absolute. So now how to use this oracle inequality in adaptive estimation. So first, because this inequality proved for any function f, for given set f, we can take the supremum from both sides of the obtained inequality. In this case, in the left-hand side, we will have the maximal risk on f of our selected estimator, and here we will have some sequence of positive numbers. Immediately, even without this limit, we can see that this guy is smaller than one. In particular, if our sequence gamma n is proportional to the minimax risk of on f, then we can assert that our selected estimator is minimax on this set. If we are given by the collection of the set, then we have a sequence is a family of normalizing factors corresponding to this family, and if this for each theta this gamma n is proportional to minimax risk on the set f theta, then we can state that our estimator is optimally adaptive. And at last, if additionally we prove that this family of normalization cannot be improved for any couple of functional of the sets from our collection, then we can state that this estimator is a gamma adaptive estimator. So we see from what we have, we can obtain a lot of result from the single oracle inequality. We can consider different collection of sets and so on. Now I would like to present to you two example of the estimator collection satisfying commutativity property. In the density model, I remind you that that our observation is we observe ID random vectors, d-dimensional vector with a common density f, and one of the maybe the most popular methods is the kernel estimation. The definition of kernel estimator is given here. It's described by the function k called kernel and the vector h, which called multibanded. So the first collection of auxiliary estimators can be constructed as follows. We consider coordinate-wise maximum of two bandwidths and then construct the kernel estimator presented here. Definitely that our hypothesis is true, and it's remain true if we consider H not just the vector, but vector function. The second example of this construction, we can construct the auxiliary estimator. We use first the convolution product of the kernel KH prime and KH. Because the convolution is commutative, we can assert that our hypothesis is verified for this estimation collection. But it's not I should say that it's not the family of kernel estimator, so it have not this particular structure. So the last two slides, I present here another oracle inequality, simply proved for another assumption. I remind you that our theorem was proved under commutativity property of the family of auxiliary estimators. And here we consider another assumption, which could be called delta commutativity, but for the non-random functionals lambda. Of course, if it's verified with delta equal to zero, it just means that this function, this functionals are commutative, this family of commutative. So under this assumption, we can prove the same oracle inequality. And in general, it's not possible to say what assumption is weaker, but in some particular situation when our lambda is just mathematical expectation of the corresponding estimate, of course the second assumption is weaker, because this assumption implies the second one with delta equal to zero. So this is the end of my talk. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for a very nice talk and a very theme that is that we need to worry about that has not been given attention for. And I would like to thank Oleg for a very, very beautiful talk. Thank you very much.
See you. Thank you, Nancy.